When I manage my Linux servers, I usually prefer the command line, but there are some situations where it actually can make a lot of sense to use a graphical user interface. For example, if you want to see some server metrics like CPU or memory utilization, or if you want to install and manage your virtual machines. And let's be honest, sometimes it's just simpler to use a graphical user interface if you're not familiar with all the commands on the Linux terminal. So in this tutorial, I will show you how to easily install a graphical web interface you can use to manage your entire Linux server. So let's go. Hi everybody, my name is Christian and I make great tutorials and content for IT professionals. I also stream every Wednesday and Thursday on YouTube or Twitch, so if you have any questions for me, just jump into my live streams. I also do a lot of live coding, live training and so on. It's always a lot of fun. So in this video, we're gonna talk about a graphical web interface that is called the Cockpit Project. And I've recently found this open source software when I was searching for a web interface to manage my Linux server. And this project was originally developed for Red Hat Enterprise Linux and CentOS, but they recently also added support for other Linux distros like Debian or Ubuntu. It's very lightweight, it looks modern and clean, it's very intuitive and very simple and easy to use. It's also highly customizable because you can extend this with plugins and other community projects that will enhance the functionality of the web interface. So if you want to install that on a Linux server, you can just easily check out the official documentation and then you will find a lot of Linux distros where it is supported and where you can install it. Note the software might look a bit different on the Linux distributions because not all features are supported and the Cockpit Project is not a complete system where it installs all the services and applications. It's mainly just meant to be an interface to manage the applications and services that are running on your entire Linux server. So in this example, I will use Ubuntu 20.0 for LTS that is installed on my home lab server and we will install Cockpit on this. I will also show you how I can easily use that to manage my virtual machines that are running with KVM and my ZFS file system by using a community plugin to extend this functionality of the web interface. So if you want to know how I've installed the underlying operating system and the system we are going to install Cockpit on, just check out the video. I've put your link in the description below. Okay, so don't waste time anymore. Let's start with the installation on Ubuntu, and this is very easy because you simply can install this with just one single command. Let's go. Okay guys, so I've already updated all the packages on my Ubuntu server and we can now simply install the Cockpit project. So to do that, just enter sudo apt install cockpit, and then it will install a few packages that are needed to run this entire web interface. So just hit enter and then we're going to install the complete system. And let's check if the service is running. So let's just execute sudo systemctl status cockpit, and then you can see the service is active and running. So now when you open this from a web browser, you can just simply enter the IP address of your server and just enter the port 9090. So this is the default port of the Cockpit web interface. And usually you will get this error message here: your connection isn't private because Cockpit doesn't obtain trusted HTTPS certificates by default, so they are self-signed. By the way, if you want to know how to use a reverse proxy to obtain trusted HTTPS certificates from Let's Encrypt and use that to expose a simple web service like this here to the public internet, you should also check out my video about setup Nginx as a reverse proxy. I've put your link in the video description below. But if you want me to do a separate video on how to expose Cockpit with trusted HTTPS certificates to the public internet, just leave me a comment down below. So this is how Cockpit looks when you want to log into the system. So as I said, Cockpit is just an interface to manage your entire Linux server and manage the systems and services that are already installed. So therefore, Cockpit doesn't have a default administrator or default password. You can just use all existing Linux users that have administrative permissions to log into the system. So for example, you can also log in with a root user, but I want to use an administrative user that is already existing on my server. And when you log in, you simply see the dashboard of Cockpit. So there you can inspect the server health, you can see the system is up to date, you can see the CPU and memory usage. If you click on view graphs, you can also see some details like disk IO, network traffic and so on. So let's go back to the overview. You can also see some system information like I'm using the Dell PowerEdge T410. I've used that server in my home lab video, and you can also inspect some general server configuration here. So you can also see there are some sections here, for example, the log sections. You can inspect any log files if you see some problems. You can filter based on severity, date and services. So that is pretty awesome if you quickly want to inspect some things and troubleshoot some issues. You can also see some storage devices here. So for example, your disk read and write operations, your storage logs and so on. So note, you cannot manage ZFS with that, but I will show you this later. You can also see some networking graphs. You can see interfaces here, unmanaged interfaces, and add new VLANs or bridges here. You could also see the sending and receiving kilobits per second. You can also add other Linux users. So you can see this is my user I'm currently logged in with, but you can also create other Linux users here. You can also start and stop services, sockets, timers, paths, and so on, so you can manage your entire Linux server with that. You also have a web terminal. For example, if you still want to use some terminal commands, you can simply just do that with a web interface, which is pretty awesome. And you can also go here to the dashboard and see some nice server metrics here. So when you see this here, servers, you can also see there's just one server that is called the X server 1, where I'm currently logged in with. But you can also add other servers here. For example, you can install Cockpit on different Linux servers, add the IP address or the host name here, and manage multiple servers with one master server. So I think this is absolutely awesome if you have multiple servers and you want to manage a full stack of different Linux servers with that. But let's go back here and let's go to the software updates, because if we click on check updates, you will see something like this here: cannot refresh cache whilst offline. So this occurs on Ubuntu 20.04 LTS. And the reason is because Ubuntu has recently changed their network management from network-manager to netplan. And this is something Cockpit doesn't expect or Cockpit doesn't support. And this is also pretty unfortunate. As I said, Cockpit is best supported on CentOS or Red Hat Enterprise Linux. And for other distributions, there probably are some problems like this one here. But there is an easy workaround, because we can easily change the configuration file of netplan to manage one single interface with a network-manager, and then you will fix this issue. So let me show you how to do that. So to fix the problem, go to the folder etc netplan and just execute an ls command. So there you should see one configuration file that helps the configuration to your interface, and then you can simply edit this configuration file with any text editor. So this file here was created by the Ubuntu installer, but note it can look different depending on what configuration you have on your server. So the thing you need to change is we need to add one new line here. So it also can be anywhere in this configuration file, it really doesn't matter so much. But enter a new attribute that is called renderer under the network settings, and then enter network manager. So note you need to write and exit this file, and then you simply just need to execute sudo netplan try. So then you need to enter this here, and the configuration was accepted. Let's go back to our Cockpit installation. Note you need to reload this whole page here, and then you simply go to networking. Now you should see a difference here. As you can remember, we had everything here in the unmanaged interfaces, but now it changed so that Inu1 and Inu2 and the virtual bridge are now managed by the network manager, and we can now use Cockpit to make changes to this interface here. So for example, you can also edit the IP addresses here and do some configurations to this interface. So note this was not possible before. And now if we go to the software, we can see the system is up to date, and you can also click on check for updates. It should now work fine, and you can simply perform any updates on Ubuntu with Cockpit as well. But one of the best features for me personally is to manage virtual machines with Cockpit that are running on a KVM hypervisor on the Linux operating system. So the problem is, if you want to manage your virtual machines running on KVM hypervisor, you usually would use something like virt manager that is only natively running on Linux. And because of that, I needed to use Windows Subsystem for Linux as a workaround to manage my virtual machines running on my Ubuntu server. But with the web interface, this is actually much, much more easy. So let me also show you how to easily manage virtual machines with Cockpit, because you need to install a simple plugin to enable this functionality. So let's go. So let's simply install a new package that is called cockpit-machines. So this is existing on Ubuntu. So if we go back to our interface here, we need to do reload here. So just reload the page, and you will see a new section that is called virtual machines. Just click on that So because I'm running some virtual machines already on this system, this is now detecting everything. So this is very easy. As I said, this is just an interface. It will automatically detect all your machines you have created with Virt Manager or through the Virt install terminal command. This is absolutely awesome. You can also see you can manage your virtual bridges here. You can create new virtual networks. And if you go back to the virtual machine, you can also manage the storage pool. So for example, I have created a ZFS storage pool here with my VM store, where I have created my virtual hard drives and also some ISO images that I'm using to install the virtual machines. So let's go back here and let's see some details of the Ubuntu server. You can see it has 2 gigs of memory, 4 CPU cores, and you can also see the usage, the disks and network interfaces that are attached, and you can also start the virtual machine and attach a console here. So that is absolutely awesome. Let me show you how to do that. So if I click on run, it will automatically start the virtual machine, and you can see you can now restart and shut down the machine. You can also see the usage here, the CPU and memory usage. And if you go to the console, you can select here what you want to do. If you want to see a serial console, you can directly attach a command line here to this virtual machine. So let's create a new virtual machine that I can show you how easy this is. Create a new virtual machine that is called Ubuntu Server 2, for example. You can also download an operating system directly from Cockpit here, so you don't need to download an ISO file before doing this. But if you want to use an ISO file, you can also click here on local install media, and then you can select the path to the ISO file. For example, I've stored some ISOs here in this folder, and we can use this Ubuntu 20.04 LTS image here to install a new virtual machine. It automatically detects the operating system and you can create a new storage pool. So because I'm using ZFS as my file system, I want to store them somewhere differently. So I just click on vm-store and this volume here is already existing. So click on no storage. Just enter 4 gigs of memory and deselect immediately start VM here. So let's create this first. Okay, so now we can edit some things here because I have not created a disk. Now if I go to add disk, I can select some different options that were not existing in the wizard before. So we can now add a pool here and we can add a new volume. So just give it a name, give it a size and just click on add. And now you can simply just install the machine. Click on install. So this is now creating the installation. It automatically starts a console where you can easily do the installation from a graphical interface here. So you don't need to install any VNC client on your computer. You can just use a VNC client that is built into the web interface. And I think this is absolutely amazing. This is really, really useful and very easy to manage your virtual machines with. As I said, I also use Cockpit to manage my ZFS storage pools, but it doesn't have any official plugin that is supported by Cockpit Project. So to do that, we can just use a community project I've recently found that is able to manage your ZFS file system with Cockpit. Note, this is not officially released, so this is not considered to be used in production environments, but I was testing this, it works pretty well, and it is community driven. So you can find the source code on GitHub and you can easily clone this project into your plugins folder of Cockpit. Let me show you how to do that. So this open source project is maintained by Optimans, and you can see this project is not considered as a release version. So there's a big warning here. This is currently pre-release software, use it at your own risk. So I would not consider that to use in any production environment, but you can definitely use that to manage your home lab server with that. So you can find some interesting screenshots. It's very, very cool. So if you want to install that, you can simply just copy and paste these commands. Let me explain what they do. So it automatically clones this repository here, and then it copies all those files that are in this repository to this location here, the user share cockpit. If you have any custom plugins you want to install, just copy these plugins into this folder and you're done. So this is very, very easy. Let me just copy those commands here. Just go to my terminal and then I will use a simple trick that is called the Control X E key, and then it automatically opens my default text editor where I can place those commands and I can edit them first. For example, I will remove these things here. And this should be fine. So this should just copy everything in this folder. Let me just save and exit this editor and execute those commands. And you can see it's automatically cloning and copying those files. And then you can see it automatically added a section that is called ZFS. So when I click on this here, you can see your storage pool. So this is a welcome screen and we can just click on configure here. So this will automatically also configure a Samba server. I don't mind if you don't need that, you can simply deactivate it, but it probably could be very useful. So you can see I have already created a storage pool through the command line. And as I said, it's automatically detecting this because this is just an interface to manage what's already existing on your server. So click on store and you can see there is our storage pool. You can also check the status here, and there you can see I have a striped mirrored pool. So this is something I have created in my home lab video. And a quick reminder, if you want to see how I've set up this through the command line terminal, you should check out my video about my home lab server. Of course, I also can create other storage pools here. For example, you can select if you want to be this a disk, a mirror, a RAID Z1, 2 or 3, and adjust all the details. So this is very, very powerful. You can also manage caches here, deduplication and so on. So this is very, very mature. I think it's working very well. Even if this is just a test version, it has many different features and I think this is absolutely an awesome project. So this is how you can easily use cockpit to manage your entire Linux server with it. I think this is very, very useful in many situations. But what do you think? Please tell me in the comments below. Do you like cockpit? Have you used that before? Or what different web graphical user interface do you use to manage your Linux server? And if you enjoyed this video, please don't forget to hit the like button and subscribe to this channel if you want to see more tutorials for IT professionals. I also stream every Wednesday and Thursday on YouTube and Twitch. And if you have any questions, just jump into my live stream. We can have a discussion about this, or simply join the Discord community if you want to get in touch with people who share the same interests like you. Before I go, I want to give a quick shout out to all my supporters on Patreon, especially Mason, who is the producer of this show. And if you like that, if you want to support my mission to help as many people as possible to jump in the field of IT and become real IT professionals, you can just support me on Patreon. So thanks everybody for watching, enjoy the rest of your day, take care of yourself, and I see you soon.